first verse of the 21st chapter of the Gospel of Matthew. The New Living Translation gives us the following. Then Jesus told them, I tell you the truth, if you have faith and don't doubt, you can do anything like this and much more. You can even say to this mountain, may you be lifted up and thrown into the sea, and it will happen. Repeat these words after me. Then Jesus told them, I tell you the truth, if you have faith and don't doubt, you can do things like this and much more. You can even say to this mountain, get out of my way. Look at your neighbor, say neighbor, oh neighbor, my mountain is not moving. Look around the room and somebody say neighbor, oh neighbor, my mountain is not moving. Wonderful God, in the name of Jesus, as we bow locks down for the teaching, preaching of your word, God, we pray that your spirit will guide us as your word goes forth in power and authority to accomplish that for which it was sent. Wonderful God, I want to thank you right now for the greater one who lives within us. In your name, God, I pray that the Holy Ghost, who is the convictor, convincer, and persuader of truth, reveal the truth about the power and integrity of your word to every listener. And God, we pray right now that your word will be health to our bodies, strength to our hearts, renewal to our minds. In Jesus' name, bless the people. In Jesus' name, help the preacher. And all of God's children say, amen. My mountain is not moving. God bless you, as you may be seated at this time. Please allow me to refresh for you the four types of mountains that I see in our everyday lives. We have the mountains that we must climb. Somebody say climb. These are the mountains that we need to hike in order to receive the benefit from the mountain. Then you have the mountain that we are to command. Somebody say command. These are the mountains or obstacles in our lives that we should speak directly to. Then we have the mountains that we are to conquer. Somebody say conquer. These are the mountains that we will have to go in and with hand-to-hand combat conquer that mountain. Then you have the mountains that are cordoned off. Somebody say cordoned off. From these are the mountains that God has placed an access denied sign in front of. For today's exercise, beloved, and those listening to me on the web, we want to deal with the mountains that we are to command. Somebody say command. How many of us gathered here today under the sound of my voice have challenges looking us straight in the eye? These difficulties are different in that these are challenges that we are to speak to. Somebody say speak to. Why, Pastor? Why? Because these challenges or difficulties are in the way. Somebody say it's in the way. These mountains are impeding the progress of your overflow. These mountains are impeding the progress to your destiny. These mountains are in your way. Somebody say it's in my way. You can't go around them. You can't tunnel under them. You have not been able to ignore them. These are the mountains that are in your way. Somebody say it's in my way. You have tried to blow your horn, however, the mountain has not moved. You've tried other conventional ideas, and still the mountain has not moved. And because of the lack of response, you have become increasingly frustrated and angry. Your mountain is not moving. Somebody say, my mountain is not moving. Beloved, for these mountains that we are to speak to, we must learn to do things in God's way to get God results. Look at your neighbor and say, I need to get God results. Do I have anyone listening to me on the web who desires to achieve God results? Each day of our lives, we should be looking for our results, not our results. God's results are a product of wisdom. Somebody say wisdom. Wisdom is the proper application of knowledge. Proverbs chapter 4 and verse 7 teaches us, getting wisdom is the wisest thing you can do. And whatever else you do, develop good judgment. Now somebody else's Bible may say, out of all that you're getting, get an understanding. God will give us wisdom to know how to respond to our mountains. Our pericope, our selected portion of the sacred text, is housed in the Gospel of Matthew. Somebody say Matthew. The Gospel of Matthew is the first book in the canonized Second Testament, known better to many of you as the New Testament. While it is unclear as to the author of the Gospel of Matthew, it is clear that the author desires to show Jesus as the Messiah and also as the fulfilling of the Old Testament. The author goes to great lengths to craft a book to intimate, first of all, A, the coming of Jesus as God's Messiah, B, the ministry of the Messiah, C, the humiliation and exaltation of the Messiah. The text, somebody say the text. Text indicates that as a result of Jesus' hunger, Jesus is angry and curses or destroys a tree when he discovers that it had no fruit but only leaves. The text indicates that the fig tree withered at once. Please allow me, beloved, to pause right now and suggest that we should be careful of being what my grandmother called good for nothing. I wish I had some help in here. Do I have anybody in here that is familiar with the phrase good for nothing? Is the church guilty of being good for nothing? Are our various ministries guilty of being classified as good for nothing? All the hot air that spews out of your mouth can be classified as good for nothing. The text indicates that the boys were astonished that Jesus could speak to an innocent fig tree and abruptly kill it. The text indicates that Jesus responds to their inquiry by telling them to have unwavering faith, don't doubt, and you will be able to speak to your mountains. Let's say that again. All together, have unwavering faith, don't doubt, you will be able to speak to your mountains. The text indicates that whatever you ask for in prayer with faith, one will receive. Now, it is important, Mr. Brown, it is important that we understand Jesus' notion of faith. You see, Jesus did not define faith as the writer of the book of Hebrews does. Jesus defines faith as having unwavering loyalty to God. Look at your neighbor, say unwavering loyalty to God. That's right, beloved. Faith for Jesus, Susan, is having an unwavering loyalty to God. You see, prayer then expresses our unwavering confidence in God. It is my job to ask where God is in the text. It's my theological response that there is power, somebody say power, available through prayer to deal with the mountainous difficulties that we are faced with every day. Yes, the text teaches the believer that trust in God results in your command being obeyed. Look at your neighbor. Say, neighbor, oh neighbor, I'm ready to get my mountains moving. Are y'all ready? Y'all ready? First of all, you need to understand, so you need to get your mountain to move, then you need to understand that the power is not in look at your neighbor again. Say, neighbor, do you have a relationship with God? Beloved, we must have a positive and productive relationship with God. Jesus' notion of faith is loyalty. We must have an unshaken devotion to God. You see, the power of my speech is not in the words, but it is in the relationship. Somebody say relationship. Let me see if I can help somebody. My son Lee Michael does not do what I say because of the words I use, but because of who I am. I wish I had some help in here. Who is God to you? God clearly knows who we are, but do we know who God is? Where is the relationship? Beloved, let me ask you, how can we love a God that we don't take the time to really know? How can we know God unless we develop a relationship with God? You see, we have got to spend quality time with God. We have to learn how to get in the presence of God. We have to learn how to worship God in the beauty of holiness. I stop by this morning to announce to all of my listeners that we serve an awesome God. A God that is never too busy to see about us. A God that is everywhere all the time. A God that has been a mother for me and perhaps a father for you. Do you know who God is? Is God the joy and the strength of your life? Does God move all pain, misery, and strife? God promised to keep you, never to leave you. God never ever comes short of God's word. Anybody in here, you gonna pray and walk in God's narrow way? How many of you can lift your hands and say, God, to you I live. God, to you I die. I wish I had somebody in here that you are in relationship with God. I hear him right to say, what a friend we have in Jesus. All I grieve and teach to bear. What a privilege. Everything. I got to hurry on. Second, the power then is not in the words, but it's in the promise. Look at your neighbor. Say, neighbor or neighbor. It's in the promise. Beloved, we have the promise of limitless possibilities. Somebody say limitless possibilities. Each of us is faced with mountainous difficulties that keep us on the edge of everyday life. The text teaches us that the power to command our difficulties lies within the promise of limitless possibilities. You see, our faith should never wither, Chief. Our faith should never waver in that God, in that with God, we have limitless possibilities. Beloved, there is no failure in God. When we are faced with our mountainous difficulties, we are to know that we are promised the access to limitless possibilities. There are things that are out of the control of our human profile. There are things that we just cannot control. Things are bound to happen, Mrs. Vincent. And when things happen, we should take pleasure in the promised access of limitless possibility. If my grandmother were here, her theology would be pure and simple. She would say that God is able. I wish I had somebody in here that you would
Look at your neighbor, say, neighbor, when you say,